Dear students, welcome to Tungal online classes. In the last video, we discussed the anatomy of dicot and monocot root as well as dicot and monocot stem, right? So there, whatever the unique internal features that we come across in both of them, sirs, that we had discussed in the last class. And in this class, let us start with the new topic, that is, so the anatomy of the leaf. In anatomy of leaf, there we study anatomy of dicot leaf as well as anatomy of monocot leaf, right? First of all, let us start with the dicot leaf itself, right? So whenever we take one leaf and take the cross section of that one, the section whenever we take, so that moment the leaf looks like this. The leaf looks like this. See here, this is midrib region and all these are the veins as well as veinlets that you come across here. And this part, this portion, so which is exposed now, and in this part, whatever the internal structures that we see, so that we are going to study now itself, right? So whenever we take the section of the leaf, that's to dicot leaf, what are the features that we come across? Let us see now. See here, in a leaf also, here this is the entire one portion of the leaf itself, right? So this is midrib region and this is, so the towards the end, so region itself. And from this midrib region, so towards the end, we'll study one by one. Totally, this section of the leaf is divisible into, so three major parts. What are those three major parts? One is outermost single celled layer, that is epidermis. And second one is, so epidermis are two, the upper epidermis as well as lower epidermis, two epidermal regions that we come across. In between these two epidermis, there we come to know one tissue, and that tissue is called as mesophyll tissue. Meso in the sense that middle, so phylla means leaf. Middle part of the leaf, except epidermis, both upper and lower epidermis, whatever the central part of the tissue that we come across, it is called as entirely the mesophyll tissue. Okay, in that mesophyll tissue, there we come across the vascular bundles over here. The vascular bundles over here. So let us start with one by one. So what are the major parts in dicot leaf? First one is epidermis. And second one is mesophyll tissue. And third one is vascular bundles. Vascular bundles. Like this, we divide into three major portions for our study. It becomes very easier whenever we make these portions separate, right? So let us see one by one. Before that one, this dicot leaf is also called as a dorsiventral leaf. Why it is called as a dorsiventral leaf is because, so it is also called as dorsiventral leaf. So this is called as a dorsiventral leaf. Why? Because whenever you take one dicot leaf, so here I have taken an example of Helianthus annuus once again. So that is nothing but sunflower leaf itself. So there, so this portion itself is said to be as dorsal region, and this is called as ventral region. This is upper surface, this is lower surface. Here, the upper surface of this leaf is dark green in color, and the lower ventral surface is light green in color. There is a difference in the coloration. Hence, it is called as dorsoventral leaf. It is described as dorsoventral leaf. It is described as. Okay, this is one point we noted. So, one more thing. What is that? The first part. What is that? Epidermis. So I shall write here epidermis. What is this epidermis? It is an outermost single celled layer which is made up of rectangular shaped cells. Okay, rectangular shaped cells which are attached side by side without any gaps. But in this section, whenever we take the section, that moment, so observe this epidermis. This is upper epidermis, what we call it as, and this is lower epidermis, what we call it as, right? So the upper epidermis is not at all interrupted by small microscopic openings called as stomata. The upper epidermis in dicot leaf is not at all interrupted by presence of the small microscopic openings called as stomata. Hence, it is called as the continuous epidermis, right? And whenever you observe the lower epidermis, the presence of many more number of stomata are seen over here. It is interrupted by the presence of small microscopic openings called as stomata. Hence, this epidermis, lower epidermis, is described as discontinuous one. Okay, epidermis has two epidermis are seen in a leaf, and both are set as upper epidermis and lower epidermis. Okay, upper epidermis is described as continuous. Why? No stomata or less stomata. All right. So lower epidermis is said to be as a discontinuous. Why? More number of stomata are present over here. More number of stomata are present in the lower epidermis and less or absent of stomata in the upper epidermis. One point. And on the epidermis, you will find a thick cuticle or sometimes thin cuticle is present over here. What is the next point? Cuticle is present over here, which is made up of a waxy material called as cutin. So cuticle is a waxy coating present over the epidermis, and that waxy coating so is made up of the waxy material called as cutin. Very important point to be noted over here. Cutin. And this cuticle avoids transpiration, right? What it avoids? Cuticle avoids transpiration. And one more function it does. What is the next function of this cuticle? If the cuticle is there in aquatic plants, so in aquatic plants on either surfaces of the leaf, then what happens? It does not allow the leaf to degrade itself. It avoids degradation of the leaf in water. It avoids degradation of leaf in water. So there are two major functions of this cuticle is there. So this is more important aspect to be remembered. And one more thing, so the hair like projection, multicellular hair like projections are seen on either surfaces in dicot leaf, right? What are present there? You come across what? Multicellular hairs are present on either surfaces of leaf, right? So this is also more important thing. This is all about what? The epidermis. This is all about the epidermis. And these epidermal cells are devoid of chlorophyll pigment. So this is about the epidermis, right? So epidermis is over now. This is over. So what about the mesophyll tissue? Let us start with the mesophyll tissue now. Yes, mesophyll tissue. Mesophyll tissue means what? It is the tissue lying in between both the epidermis. The tissue lying between upper epidermis and lower epidermis. Okay, this is more important aspect. And the next one, this tissue is divisible into upper palisade parenchyma and a lower spongy parenchyma. This is more important point. See here, there are some elongated cylindrical cells. It is about 2 to 3 layered cell layers that you come across, and those cells make the upper palisade parenchyma. And here the cells are oval or irregular shaped cells are seen over here on the lower part of the mesophyll tissue, and this portion is said to be as so the spongy parenchyma. Like this, the mesophyll tissue is divisible into the upper palisade parenchyma and a lower spongy parenchyma. Here, mesophyll tissue is divisible into two portions, the upper palisade parenchyma and lower spongy parenchyma. So like this, there are two types of parenchyma that we see over here. And these palisade parenchyma cells are elongated and cylindrical in shape. How these palisade parenchyma cells? Palisade parenchyma cells are elongated, cylindrical, cylindrical in shape. So which are present below the epidermis, that's to upper epidermis, and they are lying right angles to the upper epidermis. One more point, they are lying right angles to the upper epidermis. Point to be noted. Very important point. Okay. Next one. These cells consisting of green dots over here. And those green dots are nothing but they are chloroplasts. What they are? Chloroplast. Many number of chloroplasts are seen in this zone of the leaf, that is palisade parenchymatous part. So hence this portion of the leaf is said to be as the photosynthetic zone. What it is known as? Photosynthetic zone. Palisade parenchyma tissue which makes the photosynthetic zone. Why? Because many number of chloroplasts are present over there. Hence it is photosynthetic zone. Means much of the photosynthesis is taking place on the upper palisade parenchymatous tissue, right? And the lower spongy tissue has the irregular shaped or oval shaped cells, and they contain very less number of chloroplasts. Here spongy tissue consist of very less number of chloroplasts. Very less number of chloroplast it consisting of. Less photosynthesis is taking place there. That's all, right? So this is about the mesophyll tissue. What it is? Mesophyll tissue. Okay, this is about the mesophyll tissue. In the mesophyll tissue, so there you come across the veins and veinlets. This is more important aspect. Remember, veins and veinlets are present over there. And those veins and veinlets consisting of both xylem as well as phloem, both together form the bundle. See here, this is xylem, this is phloem. Both together form one bundle, and that bundle is nothing but vascular bundle. Then where are these vascular bundles mainly present? They are present. So whenever you draw the leaf, that moment you will come to know this is the leaf. What is the stalk of the leaf called as? Petiole. And what is this one? Midrib it is. Midrib, right? And what these are? These are nothing but they are the veins. Okay, when these veins branch themselves, these are called as veinlets. Then automatically you will come to know here the vascular bundles enter into this leaf, and ultimately it goes along with the midrib and it reaches the tip of the leaf. And this vein, this is main vein, is called as midrib, and that makes some of the branches, and those branches become what? The veins as well as veinlets, like this. And in all these structures, what is present? So vascular bundles are present in the midrib, veins as well as veinlets. Okay, you came to know where actually these vascular bundles are present. See here, here and there, wherever the veinlets as well as veins that you come across, there you find the vascular bundles. And in midrib, there is a large vascular bundle is present over here. I hope you are so much clear about this one. Okay, so let us start with after this mesophyll tissue, what is the next portion? What is the next portion? That is vascular bundles itself, right? Let us start with vascular bundles now. Yes, vascular bundle, right? So how the vascular bundles are there? What kind of vascular bundles are over here? So you are observing here the vascular bundles. See here, this is phloem and this pink colored one is xylem. Xylem has xylem vessels, right? Xylem vessels are there, xylem parenchyma is there. Every parts or the components of xylem tissue are here. And phloem has its own components, sieve tubes, so as well as companion cells, as well as so the phloem parenchyma, phloem fibers, everything is there. So totally, so the xylem is towards the upper epidermis and the phloem is towards the lower epidermis. See here, in vascular bundles, xylem is towards upper epidermis and phloem is towards lower epidermis. The arrangement. Is there any intravesicular cambium or any cambium tissue in between these two? Right? No. And one more thing, both together form one single bundle, we came to know, right? So we can observe this is phloem, this is xylem, both together form one bundle, and that is nothing but vascular bundle. Of course, that kind of vascular bundle is described as what it is? Conjoint. Conjoint. right? So if they are lying on the same radii, then it is described as collateral. And is there any fascicular tissue, or so intrafascicular cambium, or here in between xylem and phloem? No, then that kind of fascicular bundle is said to be as closed type. So then conjoint collateral closed type of fascicular bundle is seen in dicot leaf. In dicot leaf, conjoint collateral and so closed type of fascicular bundle is seen in case of this dicot leaf. And one more point, so you are observing here, so around these xylem as well as phloem, there one parenchymatous tissue cell layer there you come across. And what is this single celled parenchymatous cell layer called as? It is called as bundle sheath. Then what is seen over here? Bundle sheath is seen over here. It is made up of parenchyma tissue, right? So around the each vascular bundle, there you come across the bundle sheath over here, and that bundle sheath is made up of parenchymatous tissue. Very important point to be noted. So this is important for need, right? Bundle sheath in case of the monocot stem is made up of sclerenchyma. So all these points we should remember over here, right? So bundle sheath in case of dicot leaf is made up of parenchyma. But one small difference is there. What is that? If the bundle sheath that extend towards the upper and lower epidermis, majority of the time upper epidermis, that moment you will find the cells with a thickened wall, then that kind of tissue is nothing but collenchyma. So especially the extension of the same bundle sheath that takes place, so in case of dicot leaf, towards the epidermis, which is made up of the means bundle sheath that extends, and it is made up of a tissue called as collenchyma. Especially the extension that takes place in midrib region. Point to be noted over here. Bundle sheath extends in midrib region, and it is made up of collenchyma. It is made up of collenchyma in case of dicot leaf. So this is nothing but what? The vascular bundles. This is nothing but vascular bundles. And one more thing you must remember, what are these stomatas? What do they help for? These are all things, extra things I am going to explain now within 1 minute, okay? So see here, these are small microscopic openings that we come across in the upper as well as lower epidermis, right? So in dicot leaf, they are very less or absent in case of upper epidermis. Due to the less number or the absence of these microscopic openings called as stomata, so less amount of water is removed. The process of the loss of water from the aerial parts of the plant body is called as transpiration. So here there is no possibility of transpiration if these are absent. I mean stomatas are absent. And since cuticle is also present in the upper epidermis, since it is thin or thick, so it also avoids transpiration, right? So it also avoids transpiration. Is it very clear? Transpiration is nothing but loss of water from the leaf. Aerial part means leaf here we consider, right? So this is one important point to be noted. And this stomata has guard cells, right? Everything that you study in the next coming chapter, transport in plants, okay? So this is all about the what? The leaf anatomy, that is dicot leaf anatomy. Let us start with the monocot leaf. So what are the important features of monocot leaf? Let's study now itself. Yes, this is monocot leaf. Whenever you take the section of the leaf, that moment you will find this kind of structure. So all these veins which are lying parallel to each other, right? You are observing all these are the veins, right? So they are parallel to each other, and these vascular bundles are smaller when compared to the midrib one. So whenever you take the section of that one, and it looks like this, and so this section when it is enlarged, it looks like this. Okay, so here this monocot leaf is also called as isobilateral leaf. What it is also known as? Isobilateral leaf. And this isobilateral leaf, so both upper and lower epidermis has so the interruptions due to the presence of the microscopic openings called as stomata. Stomatas are distributed on either surfaces of this leaf equally, right? So that point to be noted over here. Isobilateral leaf, and this leaf has same color on either surfaces, on either surfaces, and both upper and lower epidermis are interrupted due to the presence of stomata. Due to the presence of stomata, stomata are microscopic openings present on the epidermis. Some of the epidermal cells, they modify themselves into the stomatas. Okay, the point to be noted. So this is epidermis, what we are explaining now. So what is epidermis? You know, it is outermost single celled layer which is made up of rectangular shaped cells, right? And one unique feature is seen in case of this. So what? Upper epidermis, especially in upper epidermis of this monocot leaf, there are some large colorless, right, cells that you come across. So compared to these epidermal cells, so these cells are larger enough, and these cells are called as bulliform cells. What these are known as? Bulliform cells. And the cells which are larger and present on the upper epidermis, so which are vacant and they are colorless in nature, those colorless large sized cells present on the upper epidermis are called as bulliform cells, or these are also called as motor cells. These are bulliform cells or motor cells, they are called as. So the point to be noted over here, right, regarding the epidermis, one unique feature, so that is bulliform cells. So it is more important for NEET examination. What is the function of these bulliform cells? The question arises. What is the major function? What kind of participation they do? So it is very important. So whenever these are present along with the veins, remember, these are present along with the, means they are interlinked with the veins itself, right? So this point be noted. So they take the water, much of the water, and they bulge themselves. And that bulged condition of the cell is said as a turgid cell. If the cell contains 90% of water and completely bulged itself, that condition is known as a turgid condition. Okay, so whenever these cells are turgid in nature, that moment they expose the surface of the leaf very nicely. So it exposes the surface of the leaf neatly, right? But whenever the excess loss of water that take place from this leaf and excess loss of water that take place from these cells, bulged cells, that is bulliform cells, that moment they become flaccid. What is the condition known as flaccid condition? Means bulliform cells have two conditions. One is turgid condition. It is nothing but a cell filled completely with water, then the condition is known as turgid condition. So sometimes it reaches a flaccid condition, means devoid or less amount of water or more loss of water whenever take place, that moment the cell becomes what? Flaccid. That moment the cell becomes flaccid. When the cell, this bulliform cell become flaccid, that moment the leaf that start to roll inside, right? It start to roll inside. So that avoids loss of much of the water. That avoids loss of much of the water. Why? Because the surface of the leaf becomes very less when it folds in. So that moment the surface reduces, and when the surface reduces, that moment evaporation of water also reduced. Transpiration also reduced, right? So this way, this isobilateral leaf, that is monocot leaf, that maintains the water content inside the mesophyll tissue as well as so the leaf itself, right? So this is the turgid condition, this is flaccid condition, the point to be noted. So due to flaccid condition, what happens here? So rolling in of the leaf that take place, that avoids so much transpiration, that avoids much transpiration, the point to be noted. Due to flaccid condition, rolling in of the leaf that take place over here, this is the point regarding the epidermis. Okay, next one is mesophyll tissue. It is mesophyll tissue. Let us study now. Mesophyll tissue. This mesophyll tissue is not at all differentiated into palisade parenchyma and spongy parenchyma. Hence commonly it is called as ground tissue, it is commonly known as. Okay, so all the cells are similar in their size, hence we can say it as a spongy tissue only, right? There are no palisade parenchyma cells are present, and these cells, almost all cells, are containing the chloroplast equally. So equal number of chloroplast are present in all the cells, right? So that is why photosynthesis occurs in all the regions of this leaf, right? So there is no differentiation at all. Okay, so this is about the mesophyll tissue, which is commonly known as ground tissue, made up of spongy tissue, we can say. Okay, so this is about the mesophyll. Main important thing is vascular bundles. Vascular bundles. What kind of vascular bundles are here? Also, more important thing as neat point of view. So, in all roots, stem as well as leaves, what kind of vascular bundles are there? You have to mention it. Okay, so that's why. So let us see the vascular bundle. See here, the vascular bundles are seen here and there. So where? So the midrib. In the midrib, large vascular bundles that you come across in the this region. So there very small number of vascular bundles that you come across there. Okay, whenever you observe the vascular bundles, what kind of vascular bundles these are, whenever we go through that moment, so see here, so this is xylem and this is phloem. Okay, green one phloem and this is xylem. Here two metaxylems are seen over here, one or two protoxylems are seen over here. Along with that one, you will find this cavity. So that is water containing cavity, which is called as lysogenous cavity. What it is known as? Lysogenous cavity. So this is more important one. So vascular bundles containing two metaxylem, one to two number of what? Protoxylem, along with that water containing lysogenous cavity is present over here. There also in a monocot stem, lysogenous cavity is present. Lysogenous cavity is seen over here. This is more important aspect regarding vascular bundle. Then what kind of vascular bundles these are? See here, both xylem as well as phloem together form a single bundle. Hence it is called as, what it is called as? Conjoined. Once again, they are lying in the same. So collateral, conjoint collateral. And is there any intravascular cambium? Is there any vascular cambium? Vascular cambium is also named as intravascular cambium. Vascular cambium is nothing but the cambium present inside the vascular bundle, remember. So is there any, so vascular cambium in between xylem and phloem? Is it separating xylem and phloem here? No. Then what kind of vascular bundle it is? Closed. Conjoint collateral, closed type of vascular bundle is seen over here, right? So this is also important thing, right? And xylem is always arranged towards the upper epidermis. Xylem is towards upper epidermis and phloem is towards lower epidermis. The point to be noted. And one more important point in xylem and phloem is, so very important point, xylem consisting of, right, what it consisting of? Xylem vessels, all right, so as well as, so xylem parenchyma is there, xylem fibers are there, all these are present over here. So in case of xylem, okay, in case of phloem parenchyma is absent over here. What is absent? Phloem parenchyma is totally absent in this leaf. Yes, so all other components of phloem, like what? Phloem fibers, sieve tubes as well as companion cells, all these are present, but phloem parenchyma is absent. This is very important for neat point of view, right? Very important point it is, right? So this is about the, so phloem itself. And one more thing is, that is, see here, around the vascular bundle there you come across what? A single celled layer around it. What it is called as? Bundle sheath. What it is called as? Bundle sheath is present, and this bundle sheath is either made up of what? Parenchyma, or it may be made up of sclerenchyma sometimes. And the extension of so what take place? Bundle sheath take place in midrib region, and that extended bundle sheath is made up of sclerenchyma. You are observing here very thick wad, dead cells you are observing here itself. So this is extension of blood, so bundle sheath, and that bundle sheath is made up of sclerenchyma tissue over here, right? So this extension that take place only in the midrib region, not in other regions, right? So this is all about what? The monocot leaf. Whenever you take the section of the monocot leaf, you will find all these important features. What are the features that I have highlighted? So they note down all those features, and they are very important for you people. And usually any one of the anatomical structure is usually asked in the examination for 5 marks especially. That's why you have to observe, you have to study so systematically all these anatomical aspects of root, stem as well as leaf. Okay, I hope you will do it very sincerely. Thank you.